Good morning.
Good morning.
We are glad you're with us today. Please fill out your information in the guest attendance registration pad to record your attendance today. Then pass the pad to the person sitting next to you. The pads are located at the end of each pew. We are glad each and every one of you could join us, and this helps us to know you are here.
The menu for Wednesday night supper this week is pork, and we will begin serving at 5:15. Supper will be followed by the program Walking with Wesley at 5:55. It's a little more in-depth study of what we're doing. And then at 7, or about 6:55-ish, if you have any interest whatsoever in going to Israel with us in February, we're going February 8th. We're going to do about 8 days in Israel, and then we will do 4 in Egypt. And we'll also go to Mount Sinai and ride camels for a couple of hours. And so if you have any interest whatsoever, please join us on Wednesday night, and I'll give you the information you need. And so I hope that you can. There are reservation cards on the tables near the doors. Fill out one of those and sign up for supper. You may also place them in the offering plate or in the boxes, or call the church office on Monday by 2 o'clock if you would.
There's one more week to buy Boston Butts for the United Methodist Man. The deadline to purchase tickets is August 28th. The cost is $40. Tickets can be purchased in the Carter Gathering area after the service or from the church office during office hours. Pickup is Friday, September 2nd from 5 to 7 at the church loop.
Next Sunday, August 28th, there will be a lunch in the fellowship hall at noon. We'll be having chicken Alfredo, salad, bread, and strawberry cake. Please call the church office and reserve your spot. The deadline to sign up is tomorrow around 2 o'clock. Donations will be appreciated, but we're not charging for anything for dinner.
On August 28th, there's a youth volunteer meeting at noon in the library. If you are a youth volunteer or would like to volunteer on Sundays or Wednesdays, please make plans to attend. Please call Abby if you have any questions.
And the rose today is placed on the altar in the sanctuary. It's offered to the glory of God in honor of the birth of Lila Meadows Maclough, daughter of Tom and Katie Maclough, and born August 17th, 2022. Proud grandparents, Granny and Pawpaw, are Scott and Laurel Farmer. sorry, Laurel, had to do that. Take note of other announcements in your bulletin so that you don't miss anything. We're so glad you're here. Remember, if you are a first-time visitor, we have a small gift for you. They'll be there at the back of the sanctuary for that. And so let's take a few moments, welcome each other, welcome those online, and let's begin the service, if you would. Everybody stand up, if you would. All right, let's go to the Lord in prayer, if we could. Come, Holy Spirit. This service is, of all three services on Sunday morning, this one has been prayed over more than any other, so the expectation is great. Lord, may you bless us as we honor you and worship you through everything that we do today. In your wonderful and mighty name we pray. Amen. Thank you, and you may be seated. Thank you.
Wasn't that wonderful? Let's just praise the Lord, okay? We're going to praise with our singing. Get your bulletin ready. Some of the words are printed in your worship guide, but turn to number 202 in a Cokesbury hymnal, and we're going to stand and sing Beautiful River, or how we know it, Shall We Gather at the River. Let's stand together and sing.
Yes, sir. I am here on behalf of the food pantry. I know you get requests week after week to bring the beef stew and the meats, but I volunteered at the food pantry on Friday, and I had only one customer come in that day, but the shelves were almost empty. As fast as we can fill them, we have had people coming in. And so I made a list of the foods that we were out of. We still have the needs for the tomatoes and the beef stew and the pasta sauce and the mac and cheese. But what the shelves were completely out of on Friday were cereals, peanut butter, rice, the staples, sugar, flour, non-fat dry milk. We were out of toothpaste, toothbrushes, all the toiletries that you get from little hotels that could be stuck in your drawers and you never think about. There is such a need for those. We do have lots and lots and lots and lots of canned beans. We don't need any more pinto beans, chickpeas, black-eyed peas. We're good with those. But we badly need the cereals and the... So if you could bring it to the church office or you can bring it to the food pantry on Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, that would be wonderful. Thank you. We appreciate all you have done. We deeply appreciate it. Thank you.
Thanks, Tia. Tia, I've been to Tia's house, and she's got Holiday Inn towels all over it. So when she says take it, she meant take it. Let's look together over the prayer list, please, if you would. A dear friend of mine, Reverend Ann Mann, that was at Cokesbury, her husband Kim died last week. It was AFib, and it turned into a massive stroke. And Kim was young. He was in his early 50s, I believe. And just please keep Ann in your prayers. His funeral was Saturday. Also, Arnold texted me this morning. Miss Nell Strickland died about 6 a.m. this morning. So please keep them in your prayers. And also Janet Latone, her mother passed away. And I called them yesterday. Jean, thank you so much for letting us know about that. And just to let them know, they may be watching online today. And so we just want them to know we're praying for them. Look over the list. Ansley Skinner, daughter of Doug and Luann. They had a beautiful baby girl, and name is Amelia. She weighed 3 pounds, and so she's thriving. And Ansley came home. Luann and Doug are back home, and we praise God for that, and we celebrate that with them. Jim Montgomery is on our prayer list. Tammy Hutchinson, Mike Wright, Charlie Higgins, our Stevens Ministry care receivers and caregivers, an unspoken request. Charles Mays is the brother of Harriet. I see Harriet in the back. David and Laura Buddenbaum are still on our prayer list. Randy Correll, nephew of Charlotte McFall. Barbara Roberts, who is Susan Montgomery's mother, who had a stroke. Ricky Chastain is the brother-in-law of Joby Scroggs. Clark Russell, Helen Mize, Ann Heron, and Linnea Lott. Please keep all of these and persons that we have in our church family and beyond in facilities here around us, and remember those in your prayers. Let us go to the Lord this morning. Heavenly Father, we thank you for all that you do for us. In fact, you've given us life today and an opportunity to worship you. We get to sing some good songs and have a lot of fun with that, and we thank you for that, O most gracious God. And yet, we look around us, there's flooding still in Kentucky, also in Las Vegas and other parts of our country and in other parts of the world. Lord, we still have war that's going on all around us. And we pray, Heavenly Father, for the Prince of Peace to come to these areas in Ukraine and throughout the world. And gracious God, bless all those that are hurting this day and give them a sense of hope. And help us to be the hope bearers to so many persons in our community and beyond. Lord, we ask all of this in the name of Jesus, who teaches us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, And forgive us of our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Turn in your hymnal to number 231 and also find 199 in your hymnal. We're going to stand and sing His Eyes on the Sparrow and Sweet By and By.
My heart be lonely. pray. Gracious God, we thank you for all that you give us. Help us to be faithful as we honor you through our tithes, our offerings, our sacrifice. And help us, gracious God, to thoroughly and to fully just honor you through our very self. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Like the faint dawn of the morning, like the sweet freshness of dew, comes the dear whisper of Jesus, comforting, tender, and true. Darkness gives way to the sunlight, while his voice falls on my ear. Seasons of heaven's refreshing call to new gladness and cheer.
Thank you, Pentatonics. Thank you very much. Well, good morning, everyone. I mentioned this at 9 o'clock, and I'm going to mention it at 11. We need some help. We need some help. We need volunteers to help with our children's ministry and also with our youth ministry. Wednesday night, we had 65 children in our children's ministry. And there's several things why I bring this up to you. We need some help so that we can split those up into more than five classrooms. We need some more teachers, and we need some retired folks to help with that. And we've got to have some more hands on deck, because the numbers, when it started last year, it started out and then it only grew. And so we could be having 80 before it's said and done in our children's programs on Wednesday nights. So please, please, please consider not only being a fill-in, but also being a teacher for a period of time. The other thing is our youth. There were only two seats available in our youth room on Wednesday night. Only two. And so that was about 43, 45 youth on Wednesday night. So we will need some help with there. We need some more volunteers. We also need about $5 million. And so if if any of you could do that, we would name it after you. It would be nice. As many of you have noted and also reminded us, we have some plaster coming off on this wall and that wall there. But we can't fix that until we fix the roof. We have just gotten a roof company $20,000 to repair the roof. The roof on this building is over $150,000. It's about 30 years old, and so we are going to do the repair work on this roof because it's a specialized company that does that. Now, to do that, we've already signed the contract, and they will start next week, $20,000 worth of work in preservation of this building. Then after the roof is fixed, then we will paint the walls, and we will continue to do some work in here. We really need to redo the carpet, but because we're having to spend in total of some of the things that are going on in the life of your church, we're about to spend $45,000. We've got some things that we've put off and we've got to do. Now, Trustees has most of that money in funds, and then the rest of it will come out of other staff members' salaries. And so you may be missing some folks around here. The reason I tell you that is just to be in prayer for it all. And also, if you've got extra monies that can help with some things, there's some things we need to do. Charlie Green class has outgrown their space downstairs in this building. And that building is not handicap accessible. And we are going to spend between $5,000 and $10,000 over the next couple of weeks to expand that classroom. But we have to also come up with some loose solutions to help make it handicap accessible. We've not been able to figure out how to do that other than to tear that building down. We don't want to put a lot of money into that building because one day in the future plans, it will be torn down. It's got to be torn down. It doesn't meet code. So we're trying to do the best that we can do with what we have. We have office space. I've got Jonathan in a closet. I've got Linda doesn't even have an office, but we will live with the office space as we continue to work in the space we have until God provides us a way to do something a little bit different. So just know we are trustees. I sat down with trustees last week, and we came up with the priority list, and all five things are must. We have to replace our dock at the lake lot. It's gotten to a point where next year it will be unsafe, and so we must replace it. But we found a really good deal with that, and so we've already signed the contract, and we are we're putting money down on it, and it'll be finished out under next year's budget when I get rid of half the staff. And so that'll be better. But please, as I said, I just want you to know that we're working on these things. And it's expensive to have a historical building, as some of you know, because you have historical homes. And so you understand that. But we will do our best to take care of space. But it's one thing that leads to another, and we can't fix those until we fix the roof. And the bid we got was $20,000, and that was the lowest bid that we got. And so the roof is about 32, 35 years old, and so we've got another about 15 years, maybe 20, and then we'll be hitting you up for about $175,000 to redo this roof. So be in prayer for all of those things. It's exciting. I mean, the problems we have are wonderful. I know of a church, they had to take pews out so it wouldn't make it look so empty. So thank you, Jesus, for having the problems we have. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
All right. We're working on 30 questions of Jesus, the catechism of Wesley. He took the catechism from the Church of England. He broke it down to 30 questions. Catechism is an answer, a short answer, short question, short answer way of learning about the Christian faith. It's not necessarily Roman Catholic. It was used in the Roman Catholic Church, but it was also part of every Protestant denomination at one time. We've gotten away from that, and so we're trying to go back to that the best that we can. We're on question number 12, and I'm going to give you a scriptural answer, and then I will take a few moments to explain it. On Wednesday nights, we're breaking these up a little bit deeper, and are able to do that, and we're looking at the articles of religion, which deal with many of these same questions. Number 12, why did God become a man in Jesus Christ? Well, there's a text that you are very familiar with. It comes from Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6. And the one that you're familiar with says, "For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and authority will be upon his shoulders. He will be named Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Eternal Father, and Prince of Peace." Now, that is a Christmas passage. You often hear it during one of the first two Sundays of Advent. We look back into the Old Testament to look forward towards the Messiah. This is Isaiah, and he's predicting what the Messiah will be like. And he's saying that a child, he's reminding the children of Israel that Messiah will be a child. And remember, on the road to Emmaus, Jesus taught the disciples from the Old Testament on what it meant to be the Messiah, and all of the places, Bill, all of the places in the Old Testament that pointed towards Jesus the Christ. Then we look at this text, and what does it mean? It means that he will have authority, and it means that he will be a wonderful counselor. Now, it doesn't mean that he's the wonderful counselor, doesn't mean he's going to be a good listener. That's not what it means. It means that he will be wise. He will be mighty God. He will be eternal Father, and he will also be a Prince of Peace. He will be a peacemaker in our world. Then Paul says in Galatians chapter 4, verse 4, "But when the fulfillment of the time came, God sent his Son, born through a woman, and born under the law." Now let me remind you of some of the things that we have already talked about over the last couple of Sundays. Remember, there are three aspects of God. We know the Trinity, that's the three personalities, not necessarily personalities, but aspects of God, the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Now, the next part of that is we know that God is omnipotent. What does omnipotent mean? All what? All powerful, all strong. We know that God is omnipresent. That means that God is what? God is everywhere, but everywhere is not God. That's pantheism. We believe that God is everywhere, but everywhere is not God. Then also we believe that God is omniscient. What does that mean? All-knowing. Now that's where the problem comes. Because if God knew, then why did God create Adam if he knew that Adam was going to fall and get messed up with that snake? And then if God knew that, why didn't God just make it without free will so that Adam wouldn't sin? Or that Adam wouldn't choose sin over relationship with God? Well, that all sounds good and fine, but God created the created order with free will. And so Adam, just like all of us, have the choice to do right over wrong. Now, you and I both know we like to sin. Sinning is fun. Oh, come on. 9 o'clock did this. No. 10 o'clock, they said, "Heck yeah, we love it." Yeah. We like to sin. Sin, it brings us some immediate satisfaction. And really, when it comes down to it, we like it. But the problem is it destroys relationships, and it destroys the relationship between God, the Creator, and humanity, the created. How can humanity be rescued out of this rebellion and avoid the inevitable condemnation when everyone, everything, without exception, is under this bondage of sin? Because Adam, as the representative human, but also the first human, Adam chose to destroy the relationship. And remember, when Adam and Eve chose to destroy that relationship, they all of a sudden realized they were what? Do you remember? They were naked. And so they sewed some fig leaves together to make some clothes. And so they all of a sudden realized there was guilt and there was fear. All of those aspects of that personality trait and the things that they felt. And so they fell from grace, as all of us are born under the sin of Adam. And so God knew that Adam was going to do that. God knew, you know, Abraham's a great guy, right? But Abraham made some bad mistakes. Remember all that stuff with Sarah, and then the problem with having an heir and all that mess. And every time we sin and don't trust God, that usually causes consequences to mess up around us, or especially for those that love us. Amen? I mean, really, a lot of times we don't think about how it hurts others, but it certainly does. So humanity was rescued by this choice that God made from the beginning of time, all the way through Adam and Abraham, and all the way through Jesus, the Messiah. The only way was to bring another Adam. Jesus is the new Adam. Someone who, like the first Adam, was without sin. Because remember that Adam was created without sin. But Adam chose sin. Jesus was created without sin. And Jesus chose righteousness. And so that we could, once again, be covered by the onslaught of the blood of Christ. Unless God himself entered into human history, there was no way that we could escape the entangled web of sin and the resulting condemnation that comes through sin. Now, number 13, what was the purpose of Jesus' life and ministry? John says that Jesus said, "You say that I am a king. I was born, I came into the world for this reason and this reason only." This is John 18:37. To testify to the what? To the truth. Whoever accepts the truth listens to my voice. Truth is the thing that sets us free. Sin separates. Truth draws us together. 1 Timothy 1:15 through 17. This saying is reliable and deserves full acceptance. Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. And I'm the biggest sinner of all. Paul says, you know, many scholars believe, there's all different things that people believe about Paul. But a lot of scholars today are thinking remember he talks about the thorn in the flesh, Paul does, and something that always draws him back to sinfulness. And many scholars today believe that it's his constant guilt because Paul led Christians to their death. And that constant nagging guilt that he was the cause of so many others' deaths. Can you imagine that guilt? Remember, he oppressed the church and he oppressed it with great disdain. And you can only imagine the guilt that he carried with him into his life. And so his saying is reliable and true. Christ Jesus came in the world to save sinners. He says, "I'm the biggest sinner of all, but this is why I was shown mercy, so that Christ Jesus could show his endless patience to me first of all. So I'm an example for those who are going to believe in him for eternal life. Now to the King of the ages, to the immortal, invisible, and only God, may honor and glory be given to him forever and always. Amen." That is a benediction from the early church. They used that in the early church worships. Beautiful. Now, I want us to jump back on some things we talked about over the last couple of weeks. Jesus was tempted right after the baptism. Tell me what happened. Right after Jesus got baptized by, we call him John the Baptizer, not John the Baptist, because we're Methodists. And so we call him John the Baptizer. Baptizer means one who baptizes, and really, he just sprinkled. But anyway, I'm just kidding, but it doesn't matter. But now, let's talk about what happened after Jesus was baptized. It says he was forced out into the wilderness, all right? And then he was there 40 days and 40 nights because that's a good term. We like that in Scripture. Scripture likes those kind of dates. And so what happened out there? Who tempted him? The big Satan. He said, "Move that chain, move that chain." That's what Satan said. That's what they were saying at the Elbert County game Friday night. Well, that's what we thought they were saying. All right. There's three places in Scripture that talk about the temptation of Jesus. Okay, I want you to go here with me for just a second. Don't look for it, but I want to tell you what it is. Matthew 4, 1 through 11, Mark 1, 9 through 15, Luke 4, 1 through 13. That means that it's extremely important to the early church. Because it's not only once, not only twice, but it's found three times. Now, the three temptations. He'd been out there 40 days, so he was what? He was starving. It didn't mean that he didn't drink water. It meant that he probably drank water, but he was in the wilderness for 40 days. And the devil comes up to him, and the devil tempts Jesus. not with sin, not necessarily, because it's not a sin to turn stones into bread, or the devil said Chipotle is right around the corner. And then Jesus said, but no, I can't go there because they charge for chips. All right, now, so the devil tempted Jesus, not with sin, but something that is so basic, it's imperfection. Because he was hungry, and the devil said, why shouldn't you have something to eat? He asked him to stop doing what is good. Hear me, this is so important. Stop doing something good to do something pleasing. It's not necessarily a sin, but you know, we say the kids say this in the schools all the time. So, well, everybody's doing it, but adults say that just as much as kids do. And just all it is, Jesus, I want you to go with me down this road. All it is just turn one stone into bread. Because if Jesus, if you don't take care of yourself, who's going to? It's up to you. Are you with me? You see how simple sin is oftentimes. It's just one teeny, 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 teeny little step. But then that makes it easier to make that next second step and that next step and that next step. This is what the devil whispered in Jesus' ear. All you need to do is turn that little stone into a cracker. That's it. The second temptation was, really, it was pretty good. Jesus, he wasn't asked to stop being God. Jesus simply was only asked to humble himself. Remember, Satan took him up to the top of the highest precipice of the temple and said, all you got to do is step off and little fat, little naked, childlike angels with little teeny wings will come flapping around and just lower you to the ground. That's all you got to do. And then everybody will say, look how cool Jesus is. The devil just said, all you need to do is jump. Everybody's jumping. Everybody's doing it. You see this temptation? It's the temptation that all of us have. 24/7. Jesus had to be tempted just like Adam was, just like we are, and Jesus overcame the temptation. All you need to do is jump. It's a temptation of power and prestige, isn't it? Really? All we need to do is do that, and then everybody will think we're cool. The third one is the hardest one of all because this is the one that catches us all. It's really pride, really. The devil took Jesus up to the top of a high mountain and said, if you'll just, all you got to do is what? What's the one word? Bow. That's all you got to do. Nobody will see you do it. But if you just bow. Just bow. One little time, I'll give you everything. See, because evil lies. They tell you everything's going to be okay. All you need to do is bow. Publicly recognize, even though God decided it was this time and this moment, why, Jesus, should you take this time and this moment? Why would you be the one? We can see that this third temptation is the most complex and the most, hear me, is the most subtle of all. And it goes about to everything that we are and who we are. If we trust in Jesus, then we participate in the obedience in the same way that we participated in Adam's rebellion. The final test culminates in the Garden of Gethsemane. You remember that? Jesus is there. He's there with the disciples, his best friends. One of his dear friends is about to betray him. But Peter does pretty much the same thing in some ways, and so they can't stay awake. Jesus says, why can't you stay awake? Just stay awake. And he goes off and he cries so dearly and desperately that blood comes from his tear ducts. Then he comes back. The disciples are still asleep. And see, this is when Jesus said is at his most vulnerable. Because he knows, because remember, he's part of the Trinity, so he knows what's going to happen. And Jesus looks to his heavenly Father and he says, take this cup from me. Do you remember when Abraham took Isaac camping? I learned something this week that I bet you don't know. How old was Isaac? Isaac was in his 30s. Isaac was in his 30s when Dad said, hey, let's go camping. When Isaac was 40, Abraham said, hey, you want to go camping again? He said, heck no. He was in his 30s. You see, Jesus walked right into the sacrifice. Abraham was willing, but God didn't desire it. But when Jesus walked right into the sacrifice, God the Father had to turn his back upon his son. And his son looked up at him and said, why have you forsaken me? The whole of Jesus' life and ministry can therefore be summed up as an invasion of the kingdom of God into the world. The kingdom of God is the rule and reign of God. Number 14, why did Jesus the Christ suffer and die upon the cross? Well, when Adam sinned, let me just remind you, that brought fear, guilt, and shame into the picture. First of all, they were scared of God because God, you know, made a loud noise. There was guilt because they were what?
Naked.
And then they also had shame because they knew that they had done what God had told them not to do. All the devil said was, doesn't it look tasty? Doesn't it look good? That's why I said, really, when it comes right down to it, we really, most of us really like sin. Galatians 6, 14 and 15 says, but as for me, God forbid that I should boast about anything except the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ. The world has been crucified to me through him, and I have been crucified to the world. Then Paul says, being circumcised or not being circumcised, what he means is if you're Jewish or you're not Jewish, doesn't mean anything. What matters is a new creation, that we are created brand new under the auspices of Jesus the Christ. Fear, guilt, and shame cause much of us to run and do really foolish things. I said a bad word at the 9 o'clock service, and there was only one kid in the 10 that was left out of the 45 that went to children's church. And so I asked that the parents put their hands over the child's ears, and I said this, that God loves us even when we are stupid. Stupid's a bad word, you know that. I said it one time accidentally in a children's sermon, and one of the kids said, my mama says that's a bad word. And then I said, well, you just told me you go get your mom and daddy beer, so it doesn't matter. I did not say that. You ask children in a children's sermon, they'll tell me all things about your family life. I know things, Lord of mercy. I could get your given to be so much higher. All right. Why did Jesus Christ rise from the dead and ascend into heaven? Why did this fear and guilt and shame move all of us into the resurrection and the ascension? Luke 24:50 says, he led them out as far as Bethany, where he lifted his hands and blessed them. As he blessed them, he left them and was taken up into heaven. They worshipped him and returned to Jerusalem, overwhelmed with joy, and they were continuously in the temple praising God. I like the story in Acts. Acts says that they were standing there looking up. And what does Acts say? I love it. There's an angel that appears and says, what in the world are y'all doing here? What did he tell you to do? Get going. Let me just remind you of this. Resurrection vindicates God the Father that Jesus the Son was indeed victorious over sin and death and hell through the power of the Holy Spirit. That's what resurrection does. Resurrection of Jesus guarantees that you and I have a future in heaven. And it also sets us apart as Christians, the resurrection does, from all other religions in the world. The ascension of Christ is the completion of the earthly mission of Jesus, and it puts everything together, and it lets us know that his death, his suffering, his death, and the resurrection all were for a reason, as Jesus ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. All right, so let me close out with one story, and then we'll go and we'll beat the Baptist. Two quick stories. These are good ones. All right. We went to trial on Wednesday, as you know, for the railroad case. For those of you that are visiting, we've been in a trial with the railroad that separates our two properties, and we've been in trial for several years now, six, seven years. One day it shall end. But we did our case to let y'all know what happened. We did the case. We presented our case. They'll do written argument due in the at the beginning of October, and then there'll be a decision between November and December, and then who knows what goes on after that. All right, so we still wait, we still pray. But we were sitting in trial, and there was a case before ours, and it was an hour before ours. And bless this couple, they were just a mess. They had a lot going on, and a lot of things going on in there. It made me think of a couple of several months ago when I went to trial with someone from our church, and they didn't know I was coming. I just showed up. I just, because I knew that this was going on. They were very embarrassed. They didn't tell me, but through the gossip, I'm just kidding. But I knew that this was happening, and so I went. And it after they got through with the trial, they came up to me afterwards. They were very embarrassed, and I said, I mean, it's okay. And they said, why were you there? And I thought, well, because I was just nosy and I wanted to know what was going on. And no, I didn't. You can learn a lot in trial, though, can't you? Can't you, Joe? Yeah, we learned a lot. I said, I went because we care. And I care, and a church cares. When I pray for unspoken requests, a lot of times that's what I was praying for several months ago, that situation. I'm not going to say it out in front of y'all because it's none of y'all's business. But I will say an unspoken request, and God knows exactly what I'm talking about, right? And I said, because that's what we do in the church. I said, just because somebody makes a really bad mistake, thank goodness God loves us when we're stupid. Right? And then there's consequences, right? And we don't like consequences. We certainly don't like consequences, but there are. But we still, even in the midst of chaos, God is a God of order, and God loves us even when we make bad mistakes. Amen? Okay, so don't forget that part of it. Then the other part is, I saw Carol. Carol went to Wednesday night supper, and then she asked me, Carol and I banter because I love her, and, you know, I listened to Carol and Jonathan. You know, Jonathan's doing Java with Jonathan, where he's teaching computer skills to folks that struggle with it, and you have to sign up and then pay him like $500, and then he will, I'm kidding, but he, and so I was listening to Carol and Jonathan in the library, and I just sat outside just for a few minutes, because over those few minutes, I would have taken the cord to that printer, and I would have wrapped it around her throat, and would have strangled her until she died. And Jonathan was so sweet, Kevin. He was like, now, Carol, you do this, and she said, well, I don't want to do that, and he said, But Miss Carol, this is what you do here. And Carol just wouldn't listen, and I would have taken the That's why he's doing that. And I'm sitting out in the hall listening. But so we go back and forth. And I said, Carol, I know you're going to heaven. And it struck her, because it's just, she said, how do you know I'm going to heaven? And I said, well, I just know. I know you're going to heaven. I just know. I said, you'd give me your last dollar if I needed it. I just know she would. And she said, well, how do you know that? I said, because you're bad with money. That's how I know that. And she said, well, how do you know I'm going to? I said, I just know. I know whom you serve. I said, you never have to say it. She said, I've never told you. I said, I know. But I know. I know. I know that I know. And I love you for that. And you're one of the people that when if you go, I kind of want to go and be with you. Not everybody, but I just know that I know that I know. I'm going to heaven. I know that. I know it. And I want as many of y'all to go with me as can go. I want everybody to go. I want everybody over there to go. I want everybody down there to go. I want everybody in the Catholic Church to go. I want everybody to go. And I'm going to do my best. But let me tell you, it's attributed to Augustine, but I don't know for sure who said it. But we'll just say Augustine said it because you don't know and you don't care. Preach. And if necessary, use words. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. 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 Our closing hymn is, what is it? Some old song that a bunch of white people are going to try to clap to. That's all I know. Sweet, oh, it can't. Yeah, we'll be going. Oh my goodness, we do have a good time, don't we? All right, hymn number 12 in Cokesbury. Sweet Hour of Prayer. Let's jive it up, y'all. Come on. Let's stand as we sing together. The altar is open.
Sweet Hour of Prayer.
Let's do it double time. Come on, we can do it. Today. Let's go make a difference in somebody's life. Let's tip big for lunch and let's honor Jesus all week. Amen. Amen. Kathy, so good to see you. We love you. Good to have some folks back. We haven't seen you in a while. And let's have a marvelous week. I'll see you Wednesday or I'll see you Sunday. God bless.